from the womb to the tomb. Presume the unpredictable. Gun salute life rapidly. That's the ritual.
Come and dine, the master call you, come and dine. Niggas feed the multitude, turn the water into wine. Come and dine, the master call you, come and dine. King Emmanuel the VII. Adonai God, Jah. Rastafari, you've stepped into the naturopathic pharmacy where we naturally eradicate disease. You are sitting in with the honorable priest Kailash Leons, the chairman of the Great Physician International. We are an enterprise that deals with the natural and the mystical eradication of disease. This is etymologically broken down, prefix and suffix. This, you not, the opposite to, the contrary to. Like if you displease, that means you not please at all. Right, that's fundamentally the meaning of this. Now when you really look at the suffix is, I mean, if you are at ease, that means you are happy, you are at peace, you feel love, you are comforted. Now when you put it together as this is, you have what we call not being at ease. So if you are feeling uneasy, that means you are diseased and you're suffering from an illness, maybe because you are drinking too many pills. Pill makes you ill. Disease. We are in the naturopathic pharmacy where we naturally eradicate disease. And the Great Physician International is an enterprise that have actually traveled the world carrying the good news of how one could actually heal themselves. Not by cutting off your toes if you are diabetic. Not by taking out your kidneys. Not by cutting open up the womb and taking up the woman's womb. But by fundamentally knowing yourself, edifying your physical structure, learning about exactly who you are, and see how the things in your surroundings actually interact with your physical structure. And as you see, we are not using the word body, because when we talk about the human anatomy, an atom me, that means that the human being is really an atom. Because when you break down the human being, his physical structure, you would get even to a lower level than the level of the cells that are very small, that you cannot even see with your naked eye. As they say, your naked eye. So if you have to see a cell, you have to use a microscope and magnify this particular structure up to 1,000, 10,000, 100,000, even sometimes 500,000 times, using an electron microscope. So when you really go into the realms of the human anatomy, I mean, you have to fully understand exactly what happens when you take a deep breath, what happens when you chew some food and you swallow, what's the process, what happens when a woman is going through a menstrual cycle, what happens when a man is actually ejaculating. Hence the reason we are the Great Physician International. We stand strong by the fact that we need to educate our people of self, number one, in eradicating of disease. Number two, we say instead of using pharmaceutical drugs, we use what we call herbs. Even biblically, when you go within the books of Ezekiel, you would see, man, the leaves of the tree shall be used for medicine. As simple as that. Oh man, how could I use a leaf of a tree for medicine? Then what does your aspirin come from? The black willow plant. Where does your morphine come from? The poppy plant. And you know the people using Botox to freeze up their foreheads to prevent it from wrinkling to look a couple of years younger. Botox come from the black widow spider an animal. So be careful what you exactly put in your system. Yet still the human structure even could produce painkillers that are even more efficacious or with greater efficacy than even the morphine that you call endomorphine. So when you know your system, yes, you are fundamentally on the track to eradicate disease. And when you learn about how you could use the herbs around you to strengthen up your system and to destroy the pathogens and all the disease-causing organisms outside there, even a human being is an organism, all of them cause diseases too. And even your microscopic bacteria and your viruses, the fungus and even the pollen in the atmosphere, many things causes disease. So we also say that people or human beings supposed to live righteously, in righteousness of salvation. Good moral habits, living right, is also a key way of making sure you are free from stress, free from pain, and free from disease. Now today, in the naturopathic pharmacy, we are specifically going to look at the topic of from the womb to the tomb. From the womb to the tomb. And keep in mind, we are just taking out the letter T and we are putting W and we are getting womb and tomb. So the human structure, the human womb, the womb of the human, being this galaxy, this blackness of melanin that is supposed to be creating life that connects you directly to her, is actually being turned into a tomb. How could this happen? Remember in the biblical diet, when we looked at the digestive system, and we looked at even from the book of Genesis chapter 1 verse 29, that reads, "And behold, I have given you every herb-bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat." And even within the book of Ezekiel, it comes and it actually just solidifies the whole idea or the whole scientific basis of a human structure needing trees, the fruits of trees for meat, and the leaves of trees for medicine. The herb shall be for the service of man. It's not just because the Bible says it, the 66 books of the King James Version, but also scientifically, we went into the realm of examining the whole structure of the jaws of a human being, the types of teeth in the jaws of a human being, and we saw that it was very similar to that of a sheep. When we even looked at the whole composition of the teeth in the jaws of a human being and that of a sheep, we saw that it was almost identical. Molars for grinding and crushing, premolars for grinding and crushing, and incisors for cutting. And remember, we said that the human being nor the sheep really contain canines, because we also looked at the jaws of the carnivores, like the dog, D-O-G dog, men's best friend, correction. Right now, I mean, dogs have their own rooms in houses, you know, and there are people staying on the outside, homeless and shelterless. And remember, I mean, I was just watching this documentary where a dog was thrown over a cliff by a soldier, and he got millions of mail, hit mail, threatening to take his life. A soldier killed a puppy, and people are protesting. The same soldier just squeezed a trigger a while ago and maybe killed 20, 40 human beings. Or press a trigger for a bomb on a plane and killed 1,000. Yet still he killed a puppy and people are protesting. So, I mean, what are we thinking of these days? So the whole structure of the jaws of a dog and that of a lion, which are both carnivores, I mean, you could see what a real canine looks like. It looks like fangs. Even the molars and the premolars within the jaws of the dog are sharp. They could tear you apart in a matter of seconds. Why? Because it shows that scientifically and anatomically, the human structure, an atom, me, look at the atoms that makes up the teeth of the man and that of the sheep. When you really look at this whole structure, we could see that man. I mean, it's obvious that the jaws of the man is more similar to that of the sheep than that of the what do you call them there, the dogs and the lion. It's different because they're supposed to be consuming different types of foods. And we looked also at the length of the digestive system of these animals. And we found out that it was true that the digestive system of a man is up to 30 feet long. Compared to that of the carnivore, which is much shorter. Why? Because the man is supposed to be consuming on fruits, nuts, grains, and vegetables like the herbivore. Hence the reason that his intestines are so long, giving the food sufficient time to actually pass through the whole digestive system, where you could even have fermentation taking place to make sure that the nutrients are absorbed from the food. But the carnivore, like the dog, a scavenger, like the pig, another scavenger, like the hen, or what they call the fowl, F-O-U-L, or you could spell it as F-O-W-L, but it's all the same. These animals are scavengers, so their digestive tract will be very short to minimize the amount of toxins that they actually absorb from the food they actually consume. Yes, because you have to be realistic. And know that, I mean, a cockroach is eaten by a fowl, F-O-U-L, F-O-W-L. I mean, centipedes, human feces, all these things are the natural food of a fowl because it's a scavenger. So it will definitely be exposed to many different bacteria, parasites, viruses, toxins. Hence, the food that it consumes is toxic, but its digestive system is directly created in a form that it could take care of all this toxic material. And the stomach of a carnivore, like a lion, is different from that of a human being. The stomach of the lion will contain specific chemicals, biochemicals that could destroy toxins and even destroy microorganisms that could cause diseases to the structure of the lion. But that of a human being, not a red bean or a pigeon bean or pigeon pea or a black eye bean or a black bean or a kidney bean, a human being, the structure of the human being is different. Hence, when a human being consume a cadaver or a carcass decomposing already, the only reason why a carcass or a dead animal would not be decomposing on the shelf in your stores, say supermarkets, they mark up the price, super markups, man, they mark up the price is very high, very difficult for the poor man to actually live, they mark up the price is very high, super markups. This is supermarkets, markups. So fundamentally, when you see your chicken legs and your chicken backs and your chicken backsides and your chicken legs and all these things on the shelf, the only reason that these chicken batties or backsides or legs or backs or thighs or breasts is not rotting or decomposing is because they are filled with what we call antibiotics. Antibiotic. You hearing me right? Oh, you figured it out. I mean, if it's anti, that means it's against. And if you're biotic, that means you are pertaining to life. So if you're an antibiotic, that means you are anti-life. So the antibiotics within the animals upon the shelves actually lengthens the shelf life, killing the microorganisms that could actually cause decomposition, and also killing the human beings, not the red beans or the kidney beans, the human beings that are actually going to consume it. Why do you think that there are so many super bugs? Bugs that are resistant to antibiotics. because the human anatomy is constantly bombarded with a wide range of antibiotics. And remember that the human being could be referred to as a biotic. Antibiotic, because the human being is alive. So if you take in antibiotics, either through your chicken or through your pills prescription, people ill, or through your meat ills, if your chicken and chips, then you are actually taking things to destroy your goody physical structure, biotic, because you are taking an antibiotic. That's why the chickens don't rot on the shelf. So, virgin and sistren, the human structure is not suited for the consumption of what we refer to as carcasses, dead animals. And as we go from the womb to the tomb, you could see that, I mean, every time someone puts a dead animal within the system, they are literally changing the system into a tomb. I mean, the only place you're going to bury any type of dead animal, any carcass, is where? Is in the tomb, 6 feet deep. But the ordinary human being outside there is actually using their anatomy that is supposed to keep the iris or the spirit of the ever-living God as a tomb, putting in dead animals, carcasses within the system that sometimes take years to actually digest. Hence the reason that, I mean, people suffer from all these diseases. Because if the cow that's a herbivore is fed upon what we call beef, intestines of the cow, the skin of the cow mixed in hay, this cow is going to get what we refer to as mad cow disease. Holy Manuel I, Celestia I, Rastafari. Yes, the cow has mad cow disease. The cow is not at ease. So when you're really looking at the realms, even as we are going to step into the whole naturopathic pharmacy, and we are going to be dealing with the whole concept of from the womb to the tomb. This cow, remember, human beings actually drink cow's milk. Cow's milk. How can a human being drink cow milk? Is a human being a calf? No. It's a human being. So a human being supposed to drink human being's milk. Even when we go into the realms of the whole aspect of the so-called cow's milk, we have to keep in mind that 80%, I mean, the ex will say 80% of all African people are lactose intolerant. But as you know, Honorable Priskelash in the herbal naturopathic pharmacy right here in the herbal garden, I mean, we go with 100%. I mean, 100% of all human beings are lactose intolerant. Lactose intolerant, yes, of the cow milk's proteins. Because this same cow milk that people say a glass a day or 3 glasses a day, I mean, this same cow milk contains 80% of the amino acid called casein. Now, casein now is the same amino acid that is utilized in the whole production of your hood glue. So, if you ever wondered, you wander in a land like Alice in the Wonder in Wonderland. If you ever wondered why cow milk looks like hood glue, well, maybe because it's just hood glue. Because 80% of the amino acid in the cow milk is the same casein, which is the same amino acid that is used in our hood glue. Now, to make matters worse, this same casein is actually very dangerous. Because among all the foods that people actually consume, cow milk, the milk of the cow, is one of the foods that has the greatest, what we call, antigenicity. This means that the bare consumption of cow milk and exposing your physical structure to this amino acid called casein, you will have what we call an immune response to this whole amino acid. Meaning that This amino acid is treated in the human anatomy as what we call an antigen. Oh, you're supposed to know what an antigen is. Okay, well, I will remind you. An antigen is any foreign material that is found within the human anatomy. And as long as it is exposed to what we call our immune system cells, they are going to develop or have what we call an immune response, whereby specific antibodies are going to be created to destroy this so-called antigen. Now, casein, the protein found in cow milk, has very great antigenicity. Hence the reason that people are actually lactose intolerant, because this cow milk is treated like an invader, like a disease, just like a virus. It is treated like a disease in your system. So whenever it enters into your system has what we call an immune response to destroy this so-called cow's milk. Why? Because it is cow's milk. And also, up to 70% of all the cows slaughtered in the slaughterhouses contain what we call pre-tuberculosis and also pre- or para- leukemia. Hence the reason I'm not a mean man, you know, but you don't know how it is. You are eating animal flesh that is 70% of which contains what we call para or almost has leukemia and tuberculosis. You are what you eat. Holy Emmanuel I Selassie I Jah Rastafari. Now, before we even look at the whole aspect of our male and the female reproductive system, as you know, we are looking at the whole aspect of from the womb to the tomb. I mean, we must analyze the whole concept of our hormones, what we call our steroid hormones. Now, the steroid hormones are all synthesized or produced from our cholesterol. Now, where do you get your cholesterol from? From your food. If the cholesterol is the precursor, meaning the foundational unit of even our estrogen, I mean, if you get your cholesterol from the pig, that means that the end product, which is estrogen, would actually have the backbone or the precursor, which is the cholesterol, coming from the pig. I mean, you are what you eat. Now, cholesterol being the precursor of the five classes of our steroid hormones. We have the glucocorticoids, for example, the cortisol. We also have the mineralocorticoids, for example, your aldosterone. And we have our sex hormones, the androgens and estrogens, and also what we call our progestins. The synthesis and secretion occur in our adrenal cortex. Now, the adrenal cortex is right within what we call our adrenal gland. The adrenal glands lie right posterior to our kidneys. Keep this in mind, the adrenal glands right on your kidneys. Okay, the ovaries and the ovarian corpus luteum, I mean, produces our estrogen and our progestin, while our adrenal gland, right, the cortex of the adrenal gland would produce what we call our cortisol and our aldosterone, and the testes of the man would produce what we call our testosterone. Steroid hormones are carried through the blood and they are transported to wherever they need to go. For instance, because of the hydrophobicity, meaning that they are water fearing, most of all our steroid hormones need to be complexed, or what you call attached to a specific plasma protein that could be used to actually carry them to the target organs. So if you need to get some testosterone to your muscles, because the testosterone is produced in the testes, it would have to be attached to a carrier protein and then transported through the blood to your muscles. As simple as that. Now, keeping in mind that cholesterol is the foundational unit or the precursor muscle for all our hormones, our steroid hormones. So our cholesterol molecule containing 27 carbon atoms would be broken down systematically using enzymes to an 18 carbon atom to give you your estrogen or your estradiol. So our cholesterol would first be broken down into this specific hormone called pregnenolone. And from pregnenolone, which is a 21 carbon molecule, would get our progesterone. And from progesterone, you could get your corticosterone or your aldosterone, your cortisol, and you could also get your testosterone and also your estrogen. Very important, because when we realize the significance of even the fact that our foods, meaning the cholesterol we get from our food, is actually responsible even for giving us our hormones. The estrogen or estrogen if you are a woman, and your testosterone if you are a man, and even your stress hormone called your cortisol, very significant. You are what you eat.